Hi, good evening, everybody. So, guys, I hope everybody is doing fine, right? And thanks for confirming, right? So, since it is the first session which I am starting from, or where I am starting from, so first, you know, before we get into this, I hope this is the first paper means. Has anybody gone through FA paper of ACCA, which is F3 of ACCA? Okay. Exempt. Okay. No, it's fine. It's fine. So those who got the exemption, right, it's okay. Those who have cleared the same, right, it is also fine. Right. So, however, the reason why I have asked you, because I wanted to discuss regarding the financial statements first. Right. I guess we already have seen that what exactly F7 is. I will talk about financial reporting paper in detail. But I believe that Manoj has already given you some sort of overview that what exactly financial reporting paper is. So financial reporting paper is actually based on, or this F7 FR paper is actually based on accounting, which is global accounting known as IFRS, right? So we will be required to know the concepts. Right, we'll be required to know the concepts, plus there are certain issues which, you know, other than the concept, we'll also be required to learn. Right, everything we will discuss in detail. Right, before we get into this, again, what kind of questions we get? We get multiple choice questions, right, as we know, right, and there are two sums which we need to solve, and everything would be the computer based exam. Right, so there are two sums which would be the scenario based question which we have to solve in the Excel, right, in the computer based exam, right? So I think we can directly start with the concept first and then move on to that what exactly is there and all those kind of stuff, right? Now before we get into this, like, when we prepare financial statement, what all statements are required to be prepared? What all statements do we prepare when we are preparing our financial statements? Yes, guys. So we have statement of P&L, statement of financial position, which is also known as balance sheet, right? Statement of cash flows, right? Then we have statement of changes in equity, and last, notes. Right. So now I think we can discuss all these in brief, so that we understand that what all statements we are required to prepare. Does everybody know balance sheet? Everybody knows balance sheet. We call it statement of financial position. Since everybody knows about it, I'll just show you that how exactly it is framed, right? You will always get a balance sheet. One is the asset side. Another one is the liability and equity side. So asset and liability both are needs to be broken into non current and current, right? Similarly, liability, non current and current, whereas equity, there is no non current current in the equity, where we have share capital and other reserves. Now, other reserves can include any kind of reserves which you may have. It could be my share premium, it could be my capital reserve, it could be my revaluation reserve. All those reserves will sit in the other reserves section, right? And we also have retained earnings, right? This is about the balance sheet. Now, the next one is the statement of income statements, right? So, income statement would have what? Profit and loss account. What goes under profit and loss account? What goes under profit and loss account, guys? Okay. So basically, revenue, or I would say all income and all expenses, right? So all incomes and all expenses would go in the profit and loss account. Whatever would be the net balance, that would be treated as net profit or loss for the business. Is that okay with all? Right. We have talked about P&L, but does anybody know about that in P&L, along with the P&L, we also have statement of other comprehensive income. You might have not seen other comprehensive income earlier. Does anybody know what other comprehensive income is? Non-business related income. Can you give us any example? Profit on sale of asset, okay. Interest on investment, okay. So there are various incomes in the business. Something called operating income. Something called non-operating income. So operating income and non-operating income. So operating income is the income which we earn from all the operations of the business, right? Any sales, any revenue, anything which I am earning, everything would be coming under the operating income. Similarly, any expenses I am incurring on the operation, my salary cost, purchases, everything will be related to my operations. Whereas non-operating income would include something which is not related to my operations. Maybe interest income I am getting. But the thing is, both of these incomes which we are talking about will be shown in the profit and loss account only. So both of these would come under the profit and loss account. If both of these are coming under profit and loss account, then what comes under the OCI? Anybody? Somebody has mentioned yes to this. Right? So those who have got the exemption may not know it. Those who have seen FR or FA paper, they might know it. So OCI means those incomes which are not routed through P&L, or I would say income which are notional gains. Notional in nature means they are there, but I cannot get the benefit of that. So in OCI, we just have five items which goes under the OCI, other comprehensive income. So there are five items. Whenever you see any of these items, you have to take that in the other comprehensive income. So the first one is revaluation gain. Whenever there is a revaluation gain, right, that revaluation gain would always go under the other comprehensive income. Similar to revaluation gain, right, revaluation gain comes on the fixed assets, right? Similar to revaluation gain, we have gain on change in fair value of some financial assets. For example, let's say I have shares of Reliance Industries. I purchased the share of Reliance Industries for rupees, let's assume 500. Now the value is 800. Is it good for me or bad for me? It's very good, right? There is a profit. When this is a profit, that gain may not go to P&L because of some cases only. I'm not saying every time, but in some. Not every time, in some times, it will go to other comprehensive income. Right? There are other items. Other items, you may not see that in this particular paper in FR, but you see that in the next paper, which is SBR. Once you clear this, you move to the next level, then you see that. Just for the knowledge, no need to remember these. You just need to remember these two. You just need to know what OCI means, right? So actuarial gains and losses. Right, when we have any actuarial gains and losses, any hedging, right, and foreign currency translation. It is a, this is just for your knowledge. No need to remember these ones. These are five items. First two items are relevant for you for this particular topic. Is that okay with all? Does it make sense? Okay. Now thing is, how this statement is prepared. How this other comprehensive income is prepared. So this statement of P&L, I'm not mentioning the name here. I didn't mention the name here. Now this statement of P&L is actually known as statement of comprehensive income. So name changed from statement of profit and loss account to statement of comprehensive income. In statement of comprehensive income, the above part belongs to P&L. the lower part belongs to other comprehensive income. And as I mentioned, other comprehensive income has only few items. So whatever the value would be, that value will come. Is that okay? So this is profit from P&L. This is gain from other comprehensive income and total comprehensive income would be total of these two. Is this okay with everybody? Does it make sense all? Does everyone understand the meaning of other comprehensive income now? Now, can you just think of like why we have revaluation gain considered as other comprehensive income? Why? What exactly it is? Though I will be talking about the same in the fixed asset topic, but why this is not considered here? Right? I just give you one question here. Let's assume ABC has purchased an asset for 10,000. Asset value increased to 15,000. We follow right. So there is a gain of 5,000. So again, I will take another question. ABC purchased an asset for 19,000, sold the same to someone else for 21,000. How much is the gain? Now, which gain would go to P&L? Which gain would go to So, what is going to happen? Since this is the change in value, this will go to revaluation reserve, which is other comprehensive income. But this one is the gain on sale, which will go to profit and loss. Is that okay with all? Right. The reason being, change in value will not make any difference to you. Okay. So, Nawal, surprisingly, you may find that similar kind of gain in different accounting standard means here we are talking about fixed asset. But if I replace this fixed asset with some other kind of asset, that gain will go to P&L, right? You can see the kind of treatment we are talking about here. So it all depends on the rule. You are right. We follow the concept of conservatism. Is that okay? Because the value is there, but I cannot enjoy the value unless I sell that, right? If I just ask you, you purchased one house for 1 crore. After 2 years, the value of the house has gone up to 1.6 crore. You want to stay in that house. What would you do? Can you start enjoying it differently? Can you start feeling differently that the value of house goes up? No, right? Is that okay with all? Is OCI and P&L clear to all? Right. We move to the third statement, which is statement of cash flows. Statement of cash flows right, would always have three types of caches, right? Either it would be cache from operation, cache from, right? Because these things we will be discussing in detail, right? So not to worry about this. Cash from investment, cash from financing activity. So cash from operating activity, financing activity, and investing activity. Okay. Tanmay has a question. What if the inventory, I purchase inventory, for 10,000, right? I purchase inventory for 10,000. Market value of inventory is 21,000. How much is the gain? How much is the gain? Okay. Right. So you are looking these two points. But for that, we need to look at the accounting standard on inventory. Okay, so has anybody, right? So I am not again getting into detail because Tanmay has asked. So I am just sharing one thought with you. At what value we keep inventory? What is the rule for inventory? What is the rule for inventory? Rule for inventory is cost or net realizable value, whichever is lower. So out of these, which one is lower? Which one is lower? 10K, exactly. When 10K is lower, it means no difference at all. Is that okay? This is just to answer Tanmay, right? So inventory, fixed asset, all these things we will be discussing further. The reason what we are trying to understand here is that what kind of statements we are having, right? I am not getting into any accounting right now. I am just showing you what is the statement we are having right now. Is that fine with all? Okay, so we have seen statement of cash flows, and then we have statement of changes in equity. Has anybody seen this statement of changes in equity earlier? Does anybody know what exactly statement of change in equity is? As name suggests, this is nothing but a reconciliation between opening balance and closing balance. So we have all the equity items. Now equity items are nothing but share capital, share premium, retained earning, revaluation reserve, or you can say other reserves. Now, what was the opening balance? How this opening balance move up to the closing balance? For example, let's say this is 1 lakh. this is 3000, this is 6000, and other results is 900. Now, what can impact my share capital? What could be the reason of change in the share capital value? It could be issue. Right? It could be issue which can impact. It could be buyback which can impact. What could impact my retained earning? Profit for the year. Or it can also have the impact of dividend. Is that okay with all? This is how we show how my opening balance is moved to this. Bonus issue or split doesn't change anything. It just changes the number of shares. Nothing else. Is that fine? Total column also, right? That's, it will be there, right, Nikhil? So basically, we are just trying to showcase that what exactly my number is. There would be total. Okay. The last one is notes. And what goes under notes? Accounting policies, explanations, calculations, and everything else. Is that okay with you? Ashish, bonus shares never increase my share capital. Okay. So the reserve which you are talking about, right? If I am getting, whenever I am taking out the reserves, right? Exactly, then the entry would be there, right? But only the number of shares changes, right? Share capital still doesn't change. Okay. So we have talked about that what kind of financial statement we may have, right? How we prepare the financial statement. Now I will open our first topic, which is tangible non-current asset. Not up to June, right? Okay. So we are having tangible non-current asset. In tangible non-current asset, we are going to cover these areas: property, plant and equipment, investment property, and borrowing cost. So property, plant and equipment is the new name for the standard, right, called fixed assets, right? So fixed asset used to be, if you know that, if you are coming from the CA background, you know that AS10 was the standard, the top accounting standard which we are covering. So fixed assets was the standard, right, which is renamed, and now this is known as property, plant and equipment, right, which is nothing but the fixed assets only. Now the question is, what do we mean by fixed assets or property, plant and equipment? What exactly property, plant and equipment is? What exactly property, plant and equipment is? I hope everybody is able to follow what we are trying to understand, right? Whatever sequence we are following for the chapter, follow that. We will come back to, you know, we'll come back to book sequence later on. Is that okay? Now, what do we mean by property, plant and equipment? Yes, guys. What is a fixed asset, if not PPE? Okay. Anyone else? Asset controlled by entity which will be used for production. Very good, Ashish. Or supply of goods or services, right? Either it will be used for production of goods or supply of goods or services, or it would be used for rentals to others, or it is used for admin purpose. Can you think about the examples? What could be the example of the first one, production or supply of goods or services? Yes, guys. Machinery, plant, right? All these would be treated as production thing. What about supply? It could be trucks, aircrafts, because these are getting used for supply of services. What about rental to others? Let's assume Zoom cars are having cars which can be rented out to somebody else. What is admin purpose? Admin purpose is my office furniture, laptops, etc. Is that okay with all? Asset controlled by entity, which will be used for any of these reasons, and life of the asset would be 12 months . Is that okay with them? and the life of the asset is more than 12 months. I hope this is fine with all. Any question, guys? Yes or no? Okay. Now, at what value we keep these asset? At what value we keep this asset? Anybody? What is the value on which we keep the asset? Right. So to know this, we say that there are two times we check the value of the asset. First, initially. Initially means when we get the asset in the books first time. So, for example, you are buying the asset or you are constructing the asset. The first time when you record the asset in the books, at what value you keep the asset at? So, initially, you keep the asset always at cost. Whereas, that was just when asset was recognized first time. But what about at every balance sheet date? Means every year, at what value you are going to keep the asset at? We call it subsequent. Means at every balance sheet date. There we have two options. Either cost or revaluation. Is that okay with all? Now, can you tell me what exactly the cost means here initially? What exactly this cost means initially? So cost means all amount spent which are required to bring the asset to current position and location. Is that okay? So what does it mean? Every expense which is required, without which asset cannot be installed or procured. Now, what all those items could be? So the first one, purchase price. So purchase price, without purchase, you cannot get the item, get the asset. Second is any directly related expenses like labor, transport, if we are importing, so import duties, any non-refundable taxes. Right. Installation cost, test runs. Is that okay with all? Anybody has any question up to here? Okay. So we will, because all these are covered in the paper before this, it is not going to come in this particular exam. But the reason why we are discussing this, so that everybody is on the same page, what we are trying to understand, right? The other expense which comes under or which gets capitalized here is borrowing cost. Borrowing cost means any interest expense. For example, let's say I want to construct a building and that construction will take, let's assume, 2 crore rupees. I don't have money. The reason is that I still want to construct that building. So what is the other option I have? From where I can get the funds? From where I can get the funds? Loan, exactly. So I have to go to the bank or anybody to take the loan. So if I take the loan, that loan comes with interest expense. Now, can I construct the asset without loan if I don't have money? Is it possible to construct the asset without loan if I don't have money? No. So Ashish, with loan only, right? So I cannot construct without loan, right? That's what I'm trying to say. So if loan becomes a required thing, it means the expense I am incurring on the loan becomes required expense and will be added in the value of asset, right? One more type of expense which get capitalized here is decommissioning. Has anybody heard about this decommissioning? What does decommissioning cost means? What does decommissioning means? Dismantling, exactly. So decommissioning means dismantling and restoring the place in original condition. So basically, what exactly it is trying to say, that let's assume ABC has set up telecom tower on your roof. Right, ABC has set up telecom tower on your roof as per agreement. ABC would keep this for 15 years. Now, what to do after 15 years? What would happen after 15 years? What will happen after 15 years? If, as per the agreement, it may extend, of course. But if it doesn't extend, then? If it doesn't extend, then what? It has to be removed. And who is going to remove? ABC. So ABC has to dismantle the tower. Will it require expense? Right. So the expense required for this would be added in asset value. Is that okay? Let's assume the expense required after 15 years to dismantle it would be 20 lakhs. Then what we are going to do with this amount? What we are going to do with this amount? We will capitalize this amount. Let's assume telecom tower value is 1 crore. So telecom tower value is 1 crore. So 1 crore is the value. And we have to add 20 lakh, which we are going to pay after 15 years. But the question is, when I am going to pay this amount? Am I paying this amount today? No. When I have to pay this amount? After 15 years. Will the value of this 20 lakh would be the same after 15 years? No. It means the value would be different. When the value would be different, we need to find out the present value. Let's assume the interest rate is 10%. So what we are going to do? We will find out the present value. Present value formula is 1 upon 1 plus R. R means rate of interest. Raised to power period. Period is 15 years. So if I do that, this 20 lakhs having the present value of 4,78,000. So I will not capitalize 1 crore 20 lakhs. I will capitalize 1 crore 4,78,780. Is that okay with all? Anybody, any question, guys? So that was all about the cost. What actually goes under the initial cost? But what about subsequently, after balance sheet date, you have recorded the asset initially at 1,04,78,000. What will happen at the year end? At what value we are going to keep the asset at? What value we are going to keep the asset at? Either we will follow cost model. Does anybody know what is cost model? Cost minus depreciation. Every year I have to charge the depreciation. Right? So let's look at So what does depreciation means? Depreciation means nothing but the usage. Now the question is, if the life of this asset is 15 years and the value is this, what would be the value after 1 year? What would be the value of this asset after 1 year? Yes, guys. Depends on depreciation method. Generally, what depreciation method we use? Right? Straight line basis. So if we apply straight line method, what would be the depreciation? So 99% times, if depreciation method is not given, always follow straight line method. If it is not given. So the value, this divided by 15 is the depreciation. And closing value would be this minus this. Okay. Right. So let's do one thing. Let's take a quick break here for 10 minutes and then we'll start the session again. Okay, guys. So 10 minutes break and then we'll start again. Hi guys, is everyone there? Okay, so what we were discussing that the cost model is cost minus depreciation, but what happens if company has chosen a revaluation model? Right. So we have discussed cost model. What if company follows revaluation model? When companies follow revaluation model, it means company would keep the asset at fair value every here. Right? Company would keep the asset at fair value every year. But company would also charge depreciation every year on the revalued amount. So let's understand this model first. So ABC has purchased the asset for rupees 1 lakh. Right? Let's assume this asset is land. Company ABC has purchased the land for 1 lakh on 1st Jan 2019. Now on 31st December 2019, fair value of the land is rupees 1,40,000. Now, what should be the value of this asset in the balance sheet on 31st December 19? So whenever we have given this information, we have to see which model company is using. If company using the cost model, what would be the value? If company follow revaluation model, what would be the value? Now, if company follows cost model, what would be the value? So company would follow the cost, which is 1 lakh only, considering this is the land. Land will not depreciate it, so it will be kept at that. But if they follow revaluation model, they will keep the asset at 1,40,000. How much is the gain? Gain is 40,000. Where this gain would go? Other comprehensive income. Is that okay with all? So let's understand the rule. Let's understand the rule. Again, I am following the same thing. Let's assume on 1st Jan 2019, company purchased the asset for 1 lakh, right? 31st December 19, the value changed to 1,40,000. 40,000 was the gain. Where this gain would go? Other comprehensive income. But if instead of gain, right? If instead of gain, let's say this is scenario A. If instead of gain, there was a different scenario. Instead of gain, the value was, let's say I bought the asset for 1 lakh, but the value has come down to 70,000. How much is the loss? $30,000. Is that okay? Where this loss will go? So if it is gain, gain is notional gain. Gain would go to other comprehensive income. But if it is a loss, loss is real loss. And loss will always go to profit and loss account. Is that okay with all? Is that okay with all? Not loss on sale. This is the value diminution, right? I hope this is fine with all. Now again, scenario changes. I purchased the asset for 1 lakh. Asset value came up to 1,40,000. Next year, the asset value come down to 60,000. How much is the loss? This came here and this came here. How much is the loss? Loss is 80,000. Is that okay with all? Does everyone understand this concept now? Where this loss should go? Where this loss should go? So again, the rule changes. Rule says, whatever profit you have already recognized in OCI first, how much is the profit we have recognized earlier? 40,000. So this 40,000 loss will be taken out from OCI. Rest of the 40,000 will be taken out from profit and loss. Is that okay with all? So it says, whenever there is a loss, first reverse the gain which you have already recognized last year. Okay. Now change the scenario. Purchase the asset for 1 lakh. Recorded a loss of 70,000. In 2019, it was 70,000. In 2020, value has gone up to 120. How much is the gain? How much is the gain? Gain is 50,000. What will happen to the gain now? What will happen to the gain now? This gain would first reverse the loss from P&L. Balance would go to OCI. Is this okay with everyone? Balance would go to other comprehensive income. So if it is gain, gain go to OCI. But if we have recognized loss earlier, then gain, reverse the loss first and then put, then transfer the gain to okay. This was about the land. Now let's assume ABC has purchased a building for rupees 50 lakhs. Life 50 years. This was purchased on 1st Jan 19. Now ABC will follow revaluation model. Fair value on 31st December 19 is 60 lakhs. Now, what exactly is the difference and where the difference would be? What is the difference and where the difference would go? So most of you have done one thing, which is 1st Jan 19, the value was 50 lakhs. 31st December 19, value is 60 lakhs. Now the question is, when you are finding out the difference, are you finding out the difference on the same date? Are you finding out the difference on the same date? No, you are finding out the difference on different dates. So to find out the difference on the same date, what exactly you need to do? First, bring this value on 31st December 19. Only then you will be able to find out what exactly or how much exactly is the difference. Now, if it is 50 lakh here, what should be the value of this 50 lakh on 31st December 19? Yes, guys. So the value would be depreciation of 50 lakh divided by 50 years. So the value comes down to 49 lakhs. Now compare these two. When I compare these two, what is the difference? Difference is 11 lakh. Is it okay with everybody? Where this 11 lakh difference would go? Other comprehensive income. Okay. Now, can you tell me what would be the value of this on 31st December 20? If the fair value is not changing, there is no change in the fair value, what would be the value of this next year? Right. What would be the value of this next year? Have we said that OCI change? Oh, sorry, life changed? No. What would be the value of this next year? Okay. What should be the value? Are you taking, what is the balance sheet value now? In balance sheet, do you have value of the 31st December 19? What would be the value of this building now? Value of this building is 60 lakhs. Then what should be the value on 31st December 20? So I will charge depreciation on remaining useful life of 49 years. And the value would come down to this much. Is it okay with all? Where this depreciation would go? So, Robin, the next year depreciation would be charged on the closing value of 31st December 19. Not on this, but depreciation would be charged on this. So, the values which we are talking about would be this much. Is that okay? Because old value has been replaced by the new value. Is it a game? Is it a game? Where this depreciation would go? Where does depreciation goes? Where depreciation goes? Depreciation goes to profit and loss account. So this depreciation would go as an expense in the profit and loss account. What was the depreciation earlier? What was the depreciation earlier? 1 year before? 1 lakh. Because of this, how much extra depreciation we are paying? Because of the revaluation, how much extra depreciation we are paying? $22,449. So, what we should do with this extra depreciation? So, this extra depreciation can be taken to the statement of changes in equity, where we have all the values like retained earning, revaluation reserve, means other reserves, and share capital, share premium. So what we are going to do with this, because this is the extra depreciation we are blocking here, so I would say extra depreciation because of revaluation, this will come out of here and add it to retained earning. Means I have taken out from revaluation reserve and transferred it to retained earnings. Okay with all? Is that okay with all? Can you please go through this example? Why we are transferring retained earning? For example, let's assume I am not doing it. How much revaluation reserve I have? I have revaluation reserve of 11. Right? Let's assume the value is not changing in next 50 years. If value doesn't change in 50 years, what will happen? What would be the value of the asset after 50 years? Zero. Asset value. What would be the revaluation after 50 years if nothing is transferred? 11 lakh. Means revaluation reserve is sitting at 11 lakh, whereas the asset value has become zero. So it says you are allowed to transfer extra depreciation year on year from revaluation reserve to this every year. Or if you don't want to transfer, what you can do? Don't do anything. At the end of 50th year, means last 50th year, when asset is completely out, then entire amount which is sitting in the revaluation reserve would get transferred from here to here. Is that okay? Either do it every year, either do entire amount in the last. I hope this is clear to everybody. So can you please go through this example? So it says asset is valued from $1 lakh to $1,40,000. Remaining life is 40 years. Now, what was the depreciation earlier and what is the depreciation now? Can you tell me? What was the depreciation of this asset earlier? And what is the depreciation now? So the depreciation was 2500 earlier. which was 1 lakh divided by 40 years, whereas depreciation change is 140 upon 40 years, 3500. How much is the extra depreciation we are charging? 1000. So this 1000 is getting transferred from revaluation surplus to retained earnings. Is that okay with all? Or entire amount can be transferred at the end. Is that okay with all? Okay. Now do this one yourself. Now quickly. Quickly, please do this and tell me the answer. So 31st December is the value. Let's understand what is the value coming up. Prinkle prepares its financial statement at 31st December each year. It bought an asset that had a useful life of 5 years for 10,000 in January 2006. On 1st January 2008, the asset was revalued to 12,000. Now, what is the revaluation surplus? How much is the revaluation surplus? What is the life? Life is 5 years. So we will charge depreciation for 2 years. Right? And 1st January 8, the value is 6,000. What is the revalued amount? 12,000. So it means there is a revaluation gain of 6,000, which will go to OCI. Now, what is going to be the depreciation for the next year? How much depreciation would be there in the next year? So depreciation would be based on the new value, right? New value divided by remaining useful life, which is 4,000. So the closing value on 31st December 08 would be 8,000. Now how much extra depreciation we are charging? So extra depreciation is 2000. So that will be transferred from revaluation reserve to retained earning. Is this okay with everybody? Anybody has any question in this? I hope this is fine with everybody, right? Can we quickly look at this also? So first of all, what we are going to do, we will say the cost of the asset is 8156, right? What is the residual value? 2000, and life is 12 years. Let's assume we are actually depreciating the asset for 1 year. After 1 year, what would be the value of this asset? So value of this asset would be 8156 minus 2000 divided by 12. So 513 would be the depreciation. So the value after 1 year would be 8156 minus 513. Okay. So this is the closing value. But what is the revalued amount? Revalued amount is coming as 15,200. Right. If it is 15,200, the difference would be considered as this way. Now, thing is that how we should consider this 15,200? Will this 15,200 becomes my value? Would be the value for the new machinery? Now, the question is, it is the value for the brand new machine. If it is brand new machinery, what should be the value of this, right? What should be the value of this after 1 year? So I will find out the value of this. This is the brand new. This is 1 year old. This is brand new. Am I comparing the right thing? Am I comparing the right thing here? No. So if I need to consider this, what should I consider? I should consider the same thing here also. It means this is brand new, would cost me 15,200. So how much 1 year old would cost me? So for that purpose, I would say after 1 year, value should be, depreciation would be 1100 and it should be 14,100. So my difference has to be 6457. Are we okay with this? Right? Because the information is not clear, we are just taking the assumption in this particular sense. Are we okay? Right? So you have to be very, very clear what exactly has been given to us in the question. Right, we can see that what is the assumption they have taken. So they have given the activities right. So this is the depreciation for year one. It means we have to check the depreciation for for how long they have not, have they given the purchase date also? I think they have not mentioned the purchase date, right? It's fine, right? So whatever we have done, is that okay with all? Right? Does it make sense? Yes, guys, is this fine or not? So remaining useful life and residual value remain unchanged. That is the reason we have taken the same remaining useful life and this residual value for this also. I hope everybody is okay conceptually how exactly we need to find out the value. If not given, this is the assumption which we have taken, right? This is the print error here. Generally, the purchase date would always be given to you. Otherwise, you will not be able to find out the values, right? So assumption, whatever assumption you are taking, always show what exactly you are comparing. Okay? Yes. Yes, Nikhil. Okay, guys, any question up to here? Anybody, any question? Right. So the last part of this question which we are talking about is, it says complex asset. What does complex asset means? Complex asset means when one asset have multiple parts which has different useful life. Now, if I say Indigo Airlines has purchased an aircraft for rupees 100 crores. Life of aircraft is 25 years. What would be the depreciation of aircraft? What would be the depreciation of aircraft? 4 crore. Simple. Is that okay with all? But if I say the life of aircraft is 25 years, but aircraft has different components like engine having a life of 12 and a half years. body having a life of 25 years, seeds having a life of 5 years. What does it mean? That will this seed which we are looking at right now, will it work for 25 years till the time I have the aircraft with me? No. How many times I will be changing this? 5 times. What about engine? Engine would be changed 2 times. Then should we depreciate aircraft for 25 years? Or should we depreciate part of the aircraft as per their respective life? Now let's assume the value of this is 50% belongs to engine, 35% belongs to body, 15% belongs to seats. Can you tell me what would be the depreciation for this? Quickly, guys. What would be the depreciation? So first, what is the cost for engine? Cost for engine would be 100 crores into 50%. What would be the cost for body? 100 crore into 35%. Seeds, 15. Now, what is the life? Life is 12.5 years. 25 and 5. What is the depreciation? Depreciation would be 50 divided by 12.5. 1.4 for the body and 3 for the seeds. What exactly is the total depreciation? Total depreciation is 8.4. If I consider aircraft as single asset, I was charging depreciation of 4 crores. Now, which method should we use? We should always use the method of complex asset, and this complex asset would always be used whenever any asset has different components. Now, can you tell me the depreciation for these? So we need to find out the depreciation using the information which is mentioned here to you. Quickly, guys. So how much would be depreciation? So first of all, the fuselage has cost of 20,000, life is 20 years. So it means that every year I will be charging depreciation of 1,000 for this. What about undercarriage? 5,000 for 500 landings. If I have already done 150 flights, how many landings we have done? 150 out of 500. So 5,000 into 150 upon 500. What about engine? 8,000 for 1,600 flying hours, out of which 400 flying hours we have already used. So 25% would be this much. Okay. So 20,000 in by 20 years, 5,000 into 150 upon 500 for this, and 8,000 into 400 divided by 1,600 for this. Is that okay with all? Any question, guys? Okay. Now, considering this is the first session, we will cover it here only. Tomorrow, we'll continue from here. Is that okay? Right. Tomorrow, we will continue from this. I will share the Excel file and everything. Right. Don't worry. Yeah, you will get the Excel file. I'll share that tomorrow. All right. So thank you very much, and we'll see you tomorrow now.